won't you greet one another, knowing that you stand on the solid rock?
As you make your way back to your seats, if you would, find your bulletin. And in your bulletin, you'll find the scripture reading for this morning. If you would, pull that out as we read together from the book of Romans. Romans chapter 8, verses 28 through 39. As usual, I read the light print, and if you would, respond as a congregation with the dark. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren.
Moreover, whom he predestined, he also called, and whom he called, he also justified, and whom he justified, these he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, then who can be against us?
He who did not spare his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies.
Who is he who condemns?
It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword?
As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us.
For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Let us praise Him today in light of the fact that we can be sure of our salvation. There's nothing that can take that away from us. We have a God who loves us beyond anything else. I pray this in your... ask you to go ahead and be seated. We're not praying.
We cannot be separated from the love of God. Let's remember that. Be thankful for that. Wonder in that as we turn and sing to 382, Be Thou My Vision. 382, singing it together.
Be Thou
As you look to the screen, remember. Thank you for your singing.
A week from Friday will be what we call on our calendars Good Friday. So I trust these songs will remind you of that. Let me just ask you to pray for a couple of things if I could, and one of them is keep praying for Ben. He leaves what day? Thursday for Indianapolis eventually, and then out to Kosovo. So you pray for him as he goes over there. I've been talking to him. We're going to see if we can't get him lined up with some of the folks there in Kosovo that we met a number of years ago, and that would be great. So you pray for him. We've been praying for Ken, and he is here. One arm in a sling, I should say, and the other arm free, but it was moving a lot better than it has been, so praise the Lord for that. You keep praying for Ken, keep praying for Lily. Tom says she's doing okay. She might be watching on the live stream, and so we keep praying for Lily, keep praying for Andy, that the Lord will keep strengthening
his body as well. And keep praying for Bill and Peggy that the Lord... Yes?
Andy was having some problems, so we had to bring Paul to be out of here
today. Oh.
So we're
hoping he'll recover. Okay. Pray for him then. He's back home. So, okay, you keep praying for Andy, okay? But the Lord will undertake for that, so... And really be praying for the next 2 weeks as we get towards Easter, that the Lord will use the message of Easter and we'll be able to see the Lord bring many folks out that Sunday morning and we can share with them the hope of resurrection, all right? Let's pray as we give. Heavenly Father, I thank you this morning. We just sang that were the whole realm of nature mine, that would be an offering far too small. Because you have demanded our life and our all. Father, this morning, this offering only represents a very small portion of what you have blessed us with. And yet it reminds us as we give, and it certainly is a way that we can demonstrate that you really are the Lord of our life. And that we are mere stewards of what is all yours anyway. So I pray that we might give in a way that honors you. Father, I pray that you would allow us to use what is given, to take the Word of God and the Gospel around the world, here at home, to be able to impact lives, and just, Lord, to do some of the normal things that we have to do here. So, Father, just may you be glorified even in our time of offering. May you be the one that we look to. And, Lord, as the offering is taken, cause us to consider the cross and the price that was paid for our salvation. I pray in Jesus' name.
Thank you. I must not keep from thee my praise. For his glory I will lift my voice and sing. O Calvary's Lamb, O righteous one, for sinners died whose sins were none. All that I have, all that I am, I owe to thee, O Calvary's Lamb. And when my eyes at last shall see thy holy face, I'll bow to thee before thy throne with those redeemed. Unto thee, O Lord, I lift my voice and sing. O Calvary's Lamb, O righteous one, for sinners died whose sins were none. All that I have, all that I am, I owe to thee.
and I surrender. Thank you for your singing.
Those are difficult words, aren't they? I mean, honestly, to say, Lord, whatever your way is, I surrender it all. I would say that for most of us, those are very hard words to really believe. Because sometimes that may take us where we don't really particularly want to be. But if we really mean it, God said that that's where His blessings are. And I trust that really for all of us, that was really being sung from our hearts, that we were saying, Lord, whatever you want. I want you to take your Bible with me and open book back to the book of Ephesians in chapter 1. We're going to spend our time this morning looking very specifically at the prayer that Paul prayed. You know, sometimes, again, we in our prayer life might say things like, boy, I wonder what I should be praying for. And the Apostle Paul's prayer life gives you a lot of different ways that you can do that. He gives you a lot of examples. And not that we would pray the words of the prayer per se, but it certainly gives us concepts and things for which we can pray, much like the Lord's Prayer was never meant to be recited, but rather to be learned and to know the kinds of things that Jesus wanted His disciples to pray. These are not prayers that I'm asking you to necessarily memorize and pray the very words, but to understand what's behind it so that you can pray these things for people. Well, we began last week in talking about we were motivated to unity by this prayer, and we've already looked at verses 15 and 16, and that's under that subject that we need to pray unceasingly. I don't need to go back there. I don't want to go back there and spend time there, but just understanding that once again, when we hear about what people have need of, that we are spending time and praying for them because that demonstrates our love for them. And again, Paul said, I don't cease. I don't stop praying. And sometimes, again, we have a tendency to forget and we don't pray like we should. And we said last week, Paul's prayer list must have been awfully long to be able to know all the people for whom he said he prayed. But I want us to go this morning, and we're going to spend a lot of time in verses 17 and 18. We may not even get out of there. I'll just set my expectation for you right now. Because the Apostle Paul says some things in verses 17 and 18 that I think are extremely important to understanding how we pray. I put it like that, praying hopefully. And notice that Paul said, I pray that. That's a really important word. This is the subject of his prayer. He prays that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, having the eyes of your heart enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of His calling, what are the riches of the glory of the inheritance of His saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of His power toward us who believe, according to the working of His mighty power. I went ahead and read verse 19 because I think that you'll notice that there are three things that are under the matter of Paul praying, and the hope, the riches, and the power. But this morning I want us to really focus on verses 17 and 18. Again, Paul reminds us the person to whom he prays, the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory. You know, if I were to ask you this morning in a little Bible quiz, what should be the, what is the object of all of our lives? What should be the main purpose of our lives?
I would like to think that the majority of you would say, well, Pastor, that's easy. 1 Corinthians 10:31, whether we eat or drink, I should do all to the glory of God. I mean, that's the bottom line of our lives. The most important thing in our life is not necessarily to be successful, and it's not necessarily to be the most well-known or any of that. The most important thing in our life is to bring God glory. He is the Father of glory. He is the one that should get all the glory from our lives. And Paul reminds us, when he begins to tell us what he's going to pray about, he reminds us that he prays to the God of our Lord Jesus Christ. Again, what an interesting phrase. Again, we're coming into that whole Easter season. Next Sunday is the Sunday on the calendar that we call Palm Sunday. That day that Jesus came in to the city of Jerusalem on the exact day that Daniel had prophesied in Daniel chapter 9, on the exact day after 483 years from the giving of the commandment to restore and rebuild Jerusalem, Nehemiah 2. You know, I've always got to get something from Daniel into a lot of these messages. And from the going forth of that commandment until the coming of the Messiah would be 483 years. And on the very day of the triumphal entry was that day. It wasn't by accident that he came in that day. It wasn't by some human manifest. It was all done because that was God's appointed day. And he came in and he was welcomed by the crowds. And on Good Friday, when he died, one of those seven last sayings of Christ, I believe it's the fourth one, he said, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus' relationship to his Father as his God is a great theological conundrum that I'll leave you to. We're not going to try to unpack all of that today, but I would say to you, that's a great concept. And by the way, in case you have forgotten, the very first statement of Jesus was, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And the final one was, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." In the middle, it was, "My God." Because it seems that at noon, when he became sin for us, when all of the depravity of our sin was laid upon him, there seems to have been somehow a break in the Father-Son relationship. Again, don't ask me how all that plays out. I don't even propose to understand all of how the Trinity works. But what I do know from Scripture is that however it worked, there seemed to be a break, and that's why he said, "My God." The God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, is the one that we pray to. The God of our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, "I can do all things." The God who said, "There is nothing impossible." The one who told the young mother to be of Jesus before she would ever know a man, that she would become pregnant with the Messiah by virtue of the Holy Spirit. And when Mary said, "How can these things be?" he said, "There's nothing impossible with me." The God of our Lord Jesus Christ, as you look at your life, if you see a situation and you say, "It's not possible to even find a solution," that's Satan speaking, not God. The God of our Lord Jesus Christ can do the miraculous. He can do the impossible. And that's part of what Paul is praying here. Now notice that he asks them to be given something. You'll notice that there are four words that relate to one area of our being, as it were, and one word that relates to another. I'll give you another theological conundrum to chew on at lunch today. This is two of them, and you might get indigestion from both of these, but anyway, so some of your translations have the word Spirit with a capital S. if your translation has a capital S. That is because the translators believed that the Spirit of wisdom and revelation is a reference to the Holy Spirit. So it has a capital S. Others of your translations, like mine, have a small s, because the translators did not believe that it's a reference to the Holy Spirit, but rather to that Spirit, that understanding, as it were, that part of man, that our spirit would be filled with wisdom and understanding. So what position do I take? I'm not really sure. I can flop back and forth. I can take either one, because I don't think the understanding gets all that much more jumbled either way. If I had to tell you if I'm over 50% on one or the other, it's as our translation has it, with a small s, not a capital S. But I could see it being a capital S because of verses 13 and 14 above. And so either way, I'm happy either way. Happy, 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 for those of you that watch that show. Anyway, but I want you to notice what we get. Now, one thing that you'll notice, again, depending on the translation you carry, I changed my translation that I carry. I carry a New King James Bible, and some of you that were following in your New King James wondered what I may have changed to today, because I changed verse 18 to read like this, that the eyes of your heart, and yours says understanding. Now, some of your translations have the word heart. So let me tell you that in this instance, it should have been translated heart. It's the word cardia, from which we get cardiology, cardiac arrest, cardiac kids, whatever. The word cardiac is the word heart. And so my point is, I want you to notice that there's going to be a bit of a difference. There are four words that relate to our minds: wisdom, revelation, knowledge, and know. And one word that has a relationship to our heart, even though if your translation says understanding, you need to understand that the word is actually our heart. Now, here's what we often do. We often differentiate and make two very distinct things between my mind and my heart. In fact, how often have preachers said something like this? You will miss heaven by 18 inches. You've heard a preacher maybe say that. And the reason is because they say this: because you have head knowledge, but you have no heart knowledge. And because of the way sometimes we frame those things, we have a tendency to so divide the heart from the mind, we act as if they don't somehow connect. But was it not the King Solomon in the book of Proverbs who said this? As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. There's not as much of a distinction between our heart and our mind as we think there is. The heart means the center of my life. My heart is all about who I am, what I love, what motivates me, what gets me up in the morning. And those other four words certainly relate to my thinking. But what we think demonstrates what we love, and what we love demonstrates what we're thinking about. They're all connected. So here's where I want to go this morning before we even move any further in this text. I think that it would be well within our need to understand the heart. So we're going to do a little bit of heart, not surgery necessarily, but we're going to do an echocardiogram. We're going to do a... Oh, now I just lost it. What's the heart thing when we put the dye in there? What's that? Yeah, an angiogram. We're going to do an angiogram. Thank you. You got to talk for me here, people. You just got to, you know. Don't forget, if you ever see my mic down here, you got to tell me, okay? So I thought about, actually, I hit it this morning when I was sitting there. I thought, I'm going to unplug it and put it down here just to see if anybody sees it. But then I thought better of it, and that was probably a good thing. But anyway, so we're going to do a little heart work here, okay? I want you to go to two verses to begin. We're going to go to three verses to begin, and then we're going to go all over. And so I hope you'll stay with me, okay? I want you to go all the way to the very first book of the Bible. That's an easy one. So just go to the book of Genesis, chapter 6. The book of Genesis, chapter 6. Now, I know that many of you have your handy-dandy electronic devices on which you have your Bibles, and that's great. And if we can make it work, we just might have something exciting for you electronically-minded people, which I won't tell you about today. Stay tuned. But jump in with me at Genesis chapter 6 and come right to verse 5. You know the context, I trust. I mean, creation has been, a couple of thousand years at least before Genesis 6. We don't really know. Could have been 4,000 or 5,000 years. We don't know exactly how many years, but it hasn't been that many years. It's not like it's been millions of years, that's for sure. And it says in verse 5, then the Lord saw the wickedness of man was great excuse me, in the earth. Now notice, and every intent of the thoughts of his mind was only evil continually. Is that what your Bible says? It shouldn't, okay? That's just one where, again, it should not read like that. It should read, the intent of the thoughts of his heart. What we love demonstrates what we think, and what we think about will lead us to what we will love. And what God said was, when it came time for the flood, every person, as J. Vernon McGee would say, on the top side of this earth, except Noah and his family, didn't think about or didn't love anything that wasn't evil. They loved everything to do with what was evil. It was all about them. Some scholars would suggest that by the time of Moses, planet Earth had a population approaching 3 to 6 billion people. Depending on how many years you allow to transpire between Adam and Eve. I mean, and I'm just trusting their numbers, folks. Like, I didn't take out my calculator. But they, based upon that whole thing of how long people lived and how long they had children and how many children, and those two extrapolate out all of those things, all those mathematical figures, they say at least 3 billion, if not upwards to 6 billion people on the planet Earth by Noah's day. And if that's true, that's a lot of people who only thought about evil. Now you and I, we might look around our world today and say, man, that looks like our world today. Well, I would suggest you look around here, because there's more than 8 of us in this room. So we don't even come close to Noah's day. For all the loss of hope you have in this world, for all of you that look at all the evil in the world and go, oh, it's going to hell in a handbasket. I mean, it's just really bad. Ask yourself, how would you like to be Noah when there's only 8 people on planet Earth who have anything but evil thoughts? I wouldn't want to be there. I'm glad there's more than 8 of us in this room. There's probably more than 8 people right now watching on our handy-dandy live stream. What I'm saying to you is, it was their heart and their minds that had gotten evil. Come with me to Jeremiah in chapter 17. Jeremiah, the contemporary of another pretty famous prophet around here at least, Daniel, a contemporary of Daniel. Jeremiah is preaching to a generation of people who had long before left God and forgotten God, and God continued to send prophet after prophet to try to change their ways, and they never seemed to want to do that. And in Jeremiah chapter 17, again, just jump into the middle of it, verse 5, Thus said the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in a man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart departs from the Lord, for he shall be like a shrub in the desert, and shall not see the good that comes, and he'll inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in a salt land which is not inhabited. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose hope is in the Lord. He shall be like a tree planted by the water, which spreads out its roots by the river. And he will not fear when the heat comes, but his leaf will be green. And he'll not be anxious in the year of drought, nor cease from yielding fruit. Sounds like a psalm to me, like Psalm 1. And then verse 9, that really probably well-known verse to you, it says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? A lot of people stop reading at verse 9. Who can know it? The answer is in verse 10. I, the Lord, search the heart. Now notice, I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings. There's another connection between our heart and our minds. I'll say it again. What we think about, we will love, and what we love, we will think about. I'll take you to one more verse before we actually begin to, by the way, we haven't even gotten started yet. Then we're going to start looking at different kinds of hearts. I want you to go to 1 Samuel in chapter 16. You know, while I'm turning here, I'll throw out a little, maybe I should wait till after we're off live stream, but I'll go ahead and say it now. Some of you have asked me what I think about the History Channel and the Bible programs, okay? I have watched, I think the first two or four, I don't know, I've watched some of it anyway. And here's what I think, okay? Do not get your full theology from those videos, okay? Or any other video, basically, especially VeggieTales. Noah was not a carrot, or whatever. I have no idea. That's how much I watch them, anyway. But I'd rather have you watch the History Channel than VeggieTales, okay? Can I just be honest with you? I think it gets it much clearer. At least it presents people, okay? And as opposed to a tomato or something. But anyway, so there, I just offended all the young families. But anyhow, it's like I told the people in Brazil, I told you this. I'm an equal opportunity offender, okay? I offend old and young, tall and thin, you know, short and not so thin. I mean, I just offend everybody. So I don't really worry. But anyway, I'm saying that to say, it was really interesting to watch the way they presented some of these things. And it was interesting to see the way they presented King Saul, for instance. And, you know, I think one of the greatest benefits to watching something like this is normally they're really well done historical reenactments. Now, again, there were a few things that are a little strangely historically inaccurate, but anyway. But I say that to say because they presented this story of King Saul. And again, it wasn't too bad. But I want you to come with me at chapter 16, 1 Samuel 16. This is Samuel coming to Bethlehem. I understand that. But, 15 is, okay, wait. 15 is, I was going to say, what am I going here? 15 down at verse 12. Says, and Samuel rose early in the morning to meet Saul. It was told Samuel, saying, Saul went up to Carmel, and indeed he set up a monument for himself. He's gone around, passed by, and has gone down to Gilgal. And then Samuel went to Saul and said, blessed are you, the Lord. I perform the command of the Lord. Samuel said, what then is the bleating of the sheep in my ears and the lowing of the oxen which I hear? Like I say, when they presented that, I thought, you know, that was pretty well done. I liked Samuel when he confronted Saul about that, because there they were. And then he said, and who's this king guy? And Amalekite king. And Samuel said to Saul, verse 16, oh, just be quiet. And I'll tell you what the Lord has said to me last night. And King Saul said, well, speak on. And Samuel said, when you were little in your own eyes, were you not head of the tribes of Israel? Did you not the Lord anoint you to be king over Israel? Now the Lord has set you on a mission and said, go and utterly destroy the sinners and the Amalekites and fight against them until they are consumed. Why then did you not obey the voice of the Lord? Why did you swoop down on the spoil and evil in the sight of the Lord? Shaul, Saul, said to Samuel, but I have obeyed the voice of the Lord and gone on the mission on which the Lord sent me and brought back Agag, king of Amalek. I have obeyed the voice of the Lord. I brought back King Agag. Now wait, you can't use the words I obeyed and I brought back King Agag in the same sentence. And then to say, I have utterly destroyed the Amalekites. King Agag, utterly destroy, obeyed. Seems to be a problem. Verse 21, and the people took of the plunder, the people, not him, of course. The people took of the plunder, the sheep and the oxen, the best of the things which should have been utterly destroyed to sacrifice to the Lord your God in Gilgal. And so Samuel said, now notice, has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? To obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. Notice, rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness as an iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you. You see, here was the problem for King Saul. He heard something. In his mind, he interpreted it. And in his heart, he said, you know what? I love myself more than God, so I'm going to rescue Agag. I'm not going to make him kill all the sheep and oxen. And what Samuel told Saul was, look, Saul, here's the difference. Obedience is loving and obeying God in everything that he said, and if you are rebellious, it is as the sin of witchcraft. That's quite an interesting verse. Sometimes we don't quite connect rebellion and witchcraft, but God does. See, our hearts will demonstrate what we really are on the inside. Our heart will always come to the fore. Now come to chapter 16, if you would. Jump in at verse 7, as Samuel was anointing the new king. And we don't have time to go through the whole thing. This was another one they presented, and I was a little disappointed. Number one, I think they made David a little too old. And secondly, they didn't go through any of that stuff about his older brothers and all that stuff. I was a little disappointed in that. Look at verse 7. And the Lord said to Samuel, don't look at the appearance, now notice, or his physical stature, because I have refused him. But the Lord doesn't see as man sees, for man looks on the outward appearance. Notice, but the Lord looks at the heart. Now I know that sometimes that verse has been made to say things that really doesn't, like as if God doesn't care about our outward appearance. I think he does. I think what's in our heart comes to our outward appearance, but I think the point here is that God looks at our heart and he says, I wonder what he loves. See, when you sang, when I survey the wondrous cross, and then you sang, were the whole realm of nature mine, that were an offering far too small. And it demands my soul, my life, my all. See, God was looking at your heart. And he was looking at my heart. And I can on the outward sing that song with all the gusto, and I can sing it well, but the question is, do I really believe? Because when God demands something from me, am I really willing to give it up? Say, Lord, if you needed it more than me. When God takes something from us, sometimes he does it to show what's really in my heart. it's been illustrated. I'll use the old illustration because I think it still works well. It's kind of like a tube of toothpaste. I mean, it can say Colgate or Pepsodent or Burt's Bees toothpaste, can say anything on the outside, and the tube can look really good, but it's not actually until you, you know, squeeze it till you know that, oh, it actually is toothpaste. It'd be a terrible thing if you squeezed it and it turned out to be, I don't know what, you know, something that shouldn't have been in there. Because it's not until you squeeze it that you really demonstrate that what's in there is actually toothpaste. God is in the business of squeezing us. I mean, God comes to us and He puts us in situations, difficulties, pressures. And He does it at times just to see what's on our inside. And what is on the inside, what you love, will come out. So let's talk about the kinds of hearts that we don't want to have. Quickly, I'll just tell you, we don't want to have a dull heart. Jesus said to the disciples, you are dull of heart. Book of Hebrews says, your problem is you're dull in your understanding. We don't want a dull heart. We don't want to be a low wattage bulb. We don't want to be the kind of people that don't listen well. We don't want to be the kind of people that aren't really hearing what the Lord says. We don't want to be dull of heart. We don't want to be hard of heart. That's that whole story of the sower. I got to do that in Sparky's on Tuesday. You know, it's one thing to talk to adults. It's another thing to talk to kindergartners. And you can find out real quickly how skilled you are in teaching if you can try to somehow talk to little kindergartners. And I'm not necessarily the best at it, but I love when I get together with them and so I told them the story of the sower. And you remember that story. It said, Jesus said that sower, as he was spreading his seed, some of it fell by the wayside. We don't have too many waysides anymore because we don't walk a whole lot. But you know what the wayside was. The wayside was the path. Everybody walked. Then they'd walk, you know, same pathway. And it would just get all trampled down. One time when we were in Bangladesh, when I was in Bangladesh, we had a funeral. A lady died, and you know, there it's like a lot of places, 24 hours, that she's got to get buried. And so we had to go out to this village. And to get to the village, we had to walk through a field, and it had a lot of rice paddies in it, and built up around each rice paddy was a small little kind of mound of mud or dirt, and that was where the path was. I mean, it was as hard as cement, you know. The problem was it was only about that big, so you felt like you were kind of, you know, doing one of the, because if you fell in, you know, your foot was going to go 2 feet deep into the mud, and so you had to be really careful. And but that wayside is just hard. And so the seed can sit there. Nothing wrong with the seed, right? Nothing wrong with the seed. It's all about where it landed. Some of you come Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, and you read the Bible, or you listen to Christian radio, or you somehow get the Word of God spread into your heart, and you're like a hard pathway. It just bounces off and goes and sits over there for the birds to come and eat. You don't want to have a hard heart. You don't want to have a dull heart. You don't want to have a foolish heart. Romans chapter 1 said their foolish heart was darkened. Talks about the way the world looks at things. But I want to take a look at these three. This is probably all we'll even get to today. I'm sorry. But let's look at these three hearts that you don't want to have. Go to Psalm 12 with me. Psalm 12. You do not want to have a double heart. You do not want to be, as James says, double-minded. You do not want to be double, have double talk, say one thing and mean another. You don't want to have a heart. Double-minded is a word that has the idea of two souls. That is almost like you're trying, again, you're living a double life. When you're with church people, oh, you talk about Jesus and you are so godly and you, oh, you look so good, and you all do, by the way, this morning. But when you get to work, your mouth becomes absolutely filthy. And when you get to other places, you'll talk about stuff that you would never talk about at church because here you're supposed to be godly. But then you get out there and you're somebody totally different. You know who you are. I believe in a congregation like this morning, there some of you are just like that. You want everybody here to think you are spiritual and you are just in tune with God. But boy, you get out there, you don't want that. Look at Psalm 12. It says, "Help, Lord, for the godly man ceases, for the faithful disappear from the sons of men. They speak idly, everyone with his neighbor, with flattering lips, and the double heart they speak." See, they're double-tongued. They have double talk. They say one thing and they believe another. You understand what flattery is, right? If you boil it down, basically flattery is this: lies. If I would have stood here this morning with these three parents and walked up to every one of them and said, "Your baby is the cutest one here." Then I went to the second one and said, "Your baby is the cutest one here." Then I went to the third one and said, "Your baby is the cutest one here." I obviously lied to at least two of them. I might have lied to all three of them. You know what I'm saying? You've heard it said before. You know, you got to be careful about that. You know, when you look at a baby, you don't always look at a baby and say, "Wow, are they cute?" Because they may be like, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I'm sorry, every baby is not cute, okay? Even all five of mine were not always cute. So I learned, somebody said, what you need to just do is go up and say, "Wow, that's a baby." You know what I'm saying? I mean, at least that's truthful. Wow, that's a baby, you know. But it could be a Gomer Pyle look or something, you know, and just kind of go, "Wow." And but see, a flattery is just a lie. If you come and see me at the door and say, "Well, Pastor, that was just the greatest message I've heard ever." And in your heart, you're going, "Man, I was so bored, I couldn't even hardly stay awake." That's flattery. That's a lie. And see, the thing is, because here's the deal. You don't know the time that I happened to hear you as you walked out say to your wife, "Man, I'm glad I said that because that was terrible today." You know, and you know, you think my ears are so bad. And I have selective hearing. I can hear what I want, not hear what I don't want. And I practice that at home sometimes. And and maybe other places too. But you understand. See, he says you don't want to be double-hearted. Wait a minute. Let's think about this. Jesus said to the people of his day, "You say one thing with your lips, but your life says something different." That's double-hearted. I mean, they would say, "Oh, Jesus, we love you." And then with their life, he demonstrated something very different. You don't want to be double-hearted. Jesus said, "Out of the heart we speak." Let me quickly take you to a second one. I want you to go to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, real quickly. Let's see if we can't get these three in. Hebrews chapter 12, there's a second heart that you don't want, and that's a bitter heart. Hebrews chapter 12, down at verse 15, excuse me, right in the middle of a sentence, actually. The writer said, "Looking carefully, lest any of you fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness spring up and cause trouble. And by this, many became defiled." It was interesting as I went back and looked at the word bitter in the Old Testament. It was a word that chametz. And this last Wednesday, I've been doing lessons for our daycare and about Easter. And so last week, I did the Passover. I thought that would be a good one. We could lead into the Lord's table and how the disciples and the Lord Jesus, they were having Pesach that night. They were having the Passover meal. And so I brought my Seder plate with me. And we talked about all the little spots on the Seder plate. And on the Seder plate, there are two spots for the bitter herbs and the bitter vegetables. And the reason they were that way was because they were reminding the children of Israel of the bitterness of life in Egypt. This word bitter. Bitterness is something that people don't want to be around. You don't want to bite into a bitter herb or a bitter vegetable and just you put something on it to make it taste so much better. I heard it described this way, and this is the way I like to describe bitterness. Bitterness is the refusal to treat others as if they never hurt you. Bitterness is keeping a record of past wrongs that have been done to you. And by the way, did you see the way Hebrews described it? It said it was a root of bitterness. I've talked about it before. I don't need to retrace all of my steps. I just need you to understand that you don't want to have a bitter heart. You don't want to have a heart that won't forgive. A heart that holds on to all those hurts and the sins done against you. It would seem that the Lord Jesus demonstrated that He had no bitter heart. After He was crucified, hanging on the cross, the first words were, "Father, forgive them." A bitter heart. A third one, and again, we can quickly move through this one, and I want you to go with me to Deuteronomy chapter 8. There are so many places we could go for this, but there's a third heart that you do not want to have, and that's a proud heart. A proud heart. I was going to go to the book of Daniel. I suspect some of you get tired of me always going to Daniel, but how could I illustrate a proud heart better than with Nebuchadnezzar and all of the things that went on in chapter 4 and how people didn't learn the lesson in chapter 5? Because when Belshazzar was having his big party and God wrote on the wall, "Meini, meini, tekel, upharsin," and Daniel finally came and said, "Oh, by the way, king, I mean, this says you've been weighed in the balances and found wanting, and your enemies are going to destroy you tonight, and because you didn't learn the lesson that your grandfather did when he realized that a proud heart led him away from God." Deuteronomy in chapter 8. Jump down right into it. Look at verse 14. "When your heart is lifted up," notice now, "and you forget the Lord your God." One of the worst things about pride is it makes you think you can do it on your own. Proud heart says, "I don't need God." Proud heart says, "God, I don't need Jesus. I don't need you. I don't need anything but me. I'm self-sufficient. I am self-actualized. I have become loved. God, I don't need anything but me." Pride says, "It's all about me." And it really isn't. It's really all about God. See, and proud heart says, "God, I don't need you. And what you've done for me in the past, I don't even want to remember. I'm going to take it out of my memory bank." Proud heart says, "I don't need God." The one thing that Nebuchadnezzar learned, right? He learned when he humbled himself before God, he was changed. See, Paul prayed that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, might give you a spirit of wisdom and understanding, enlightening the eyes of your heart. Next week, I'll pick it back up, but there's at least three kinds of hearts we want to have, and we'll look at that. But here's the thing. Can I just end like this? Maybe this morning you've never really thought so much about your heart. Maybe you're here with an unbelieving heart. You've come this morning and you've come to church and God has helped you to understand that you don't really have the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. Your heart is as hard as that pathway. And the Word of God has been planted this morning in your heart. If your heart remains that hard, before you leave this building, Satan will snatch that word out of your heart and you'll walk out the same as you did when you walked in. Could I just ask you this morning, every one of us, look at your heart. We as believers can have a hard heart, a dull heart. We can have an unbelieving heart, not for eternity, but you know what I'm saying. I mean, we can, our hearts, and what I love, I will think about. And what I think about, I will love. What are you thinking about right now? Because it tells you what you love. Let's pray. Father, I thank you even this morning because you thought about us and you loved us. When I think of the Lord Jesus dying on the cross at Calvary, I think about how much he loved us as lost sinners. And that as the song said many years ago, I was in his mind. He thought about me. Lord, I thank you for that. I pray this morning that if there's someone here outside of Christ, never trusted your Son, with a cold, dead, lost heart, that your Holy Spirit would reveal to them their great need, and that this morning they can be changed from death to life, from bondage to freedom. That, Father, this could be the day of change for them. Lord, I just thank you that your Son can be to us our personal Savior. May he be that to each one of us today, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come thou fountain.